to worship. I invite you to stand as we begin. We ask the Lord to speak to us today, and so this opening song, "Speak, O Lord, as we come to you." Speak, O Lord. Welcome to Old St. Andrews today.
Thank you. Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the reading of God's Word.
Reading from the letter to the Ephesians. Therefore, remember that at one time, you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands. Remember that you are at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in the flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And he came and preached peace to you who were far off and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him you are being built together into a dwelling place of God by the Spirit. The word of the Lord.
It's not in here. Jesus feeds 5,000. It was a beautiful sunny day as Jesus and his disciples crossed the Sea of Galilee in a boat with white sails. Jesus had been healing sick people, and many more of all ages came to see him again. That day, maybe they could hear more of Jesus' stories or see him show God's power through another miracle. When Jesus saw the large crowd of men and women and children, he asked his friend Philip, "How are we going to get enough food to feed all these people?" Philip answered, "I could work for 6 months and not earn enough money to buy food for all of these men and women and children." The disciples did not know what to do. Just then, Andrew pointed to a young child and said, "Here is a boy who has 5 small loaves of bread and 2 of fish. It is something, but certainly isn't enough food for all of these people." The boy looked very nervous as he said in a small voice, "Jesus, please take my food if you think it will help." Jesus took the 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish that the boy offered and asked his friends to have the crowd sit down, and about 5,000 people sat in the grassy meadow by the lake that day. After Jesus gave thanks to the Lord, he blessed the 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. Then he shared the food with all people who were in there that day. All 5,000 people and ate until they were full. Then Jesus said, "Now, let's gather up all the leftovers." And do you know what? There were enough leftover pieces of bread to fill 12 large baskets more loaves and fishes left than the boy had given to Jesus. The disciples shook their heads in disbelief as they struggled to pick up the baskets heavy with food. The people saw the full baskets of leftovers and began to understand that something extraordinary had happened, another miracle. Jesus smiled, and as he heard people say, "God must have sent Jesus to us." It was a day the boy and the disciples and all of the people would never forget. The word of the Lord.
Stand out for our gospel song. We'll be singing verses 1, 2, 5, and 6. Our gospel song, 1, 2, 5, and 6. Said a blessing, broke the loaves, and gave them to the disciples to set before the people. He divided the two fish among them all, and they all ate and were satisfied. And they took up 12 baskets full of broken pieces and of the fish, and those who ate the loaves were 5,000. Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Beach weekend. Does that make you smile to hear that? Those of you who went. Beach weekend. So I want to ask those who went, and particularly our children, to help me out this morning and tell me something you remember about beach weekend. Something polite we would say in church, okay? Something about beach weekend. What would you say? Amelia?
Mud pit.
Okay, that's a great memory, right? Riley, what about you? Hanging out with friends. What else? Mary? The crabs out on the beach. That was amazing. The children, it was like a zoo almost, right? I mean, it was this big circle that they dug it out. And then they found all these different hermit crabs, and they filled it up with water, and they had all these sea animals and beach little crabs and things that were in this pool. That was wonderful. So the mud pit trip that we made up the beach with AG, our leader from the camp, and getting in the mud pit, and then trying to get the mud pit off after that. So that was a great time. What else do you think? What do you think, Sarah? Anything?
Date night.
Well, it was kind of date night, too. But game night was fun. And so was talent show. And you know, one of my favorite memories. Victoria back there. So Friday night devotional time, when we were in the conference room and we were in a big circle praying, and Victoria comes into the room and says, "Here I am," and that I will never forget. That was just, you know, these memories that you have from a weekend like that. Some of them are kind of expected. Like I expected mud pit would be something that would stand out, you know, there would be a, but there were other things that just sort of happened, like the beach zoo in the sand, or that talent show with Victoria coming in, just things that happen and that you remember about a weekend like that, or other things that you don't expect that maybe happened to you in a quieter time, like I went out to see a sunset and there were a couple of families out on the beach. And I just kind of sat down with them for a while and watched the sunset. And that was a great memory, too, that I hadn't really planned on or expected. And things like that happen. And you remember them, and they get into your memory, and you remember an event like that. Well, why do I bring that up? Well, not only because it was fun, and it was a great weekend, but our gospel lesson today, what do you call this? What would you call this lesson today? Just the name of it. Feeding of the 5,000, loaves and fishes, some people call it. It's a very famous gospel story. In fact, this is the only miracle, something you can take away for trivia after church. This is the only miracle of Jesus that is in all four gospels. Did you know that? The feeding of the 5,000 is the, now of course the resurrection is in all four Gospels. But I'm talking about Jesus' actions, his work, his ministry. This is the miracle that is in all four Gospels is the feeding of the 5,000. Now look at your Gospel lesson in, not in the Spark Bible, but in the bulletin, the Gospel lesson. And let's look at how it begins, because there's an important passage at the very beginning of it. What does Jesus say in the quotes? Second line there on page 6. What does he say he wants them to do? Come away by yourselves to a desolate place and what? Rest a while. Come away by yourselves to a desolate place and rest a while. Now, I don't know about you, but quiet time and
rest is not something that really comes naturally to me. We used to have in seminary, we used to have these quiet days, and I circled them on the calendar and dread them, because I had to go to this, with my classmates, to a monastery and be quiet all day long. Now, I don't know about you, but me keeping my mouth shut for 7 straight hours is not something that comes normally to me, okay? It's not something that I would naturally do, but there are times when I get so tired, I guess you could say, or just so, I feel like I've got to stop. I just run and run and run, and finally I just got to find a sofa. You know what I mean? And Jesus, I feel like, in this passage, and his disciples, the crowds, he's in, where are we, chapter what? 6 of Mark's Gospel. Almost halfway through Mark's Gospel. And there's so much going on and so many crowds. And actually, there's something that happens just before this Gospel lesson, and that is the death of John the Baptist. You think that might have affected him too? And also we had him going to Nazareth, his hometown, and he was rejected there. So I feel like Jesus, in this passage today, that there's a lot going on with crowds and in his personal life and a time of grief. And he says, come away for a while and rest. Now, when you think about famous quotations of Jesus, you probably don't think of Jesus saying, come away and rest. That's not in my top 10 of famous quotations of Jesus. But what I'm here to tell you today is give yourself the permission that God gives you to rest. Sometimes we feel like we've got to go, go, go for God. But sometimes God is just looking at us and saying, you need to take a break. Every race car needs a pit stop. This first part, this first quote of Jesus in this passage today is the part about quiet. Now, when I was getting ready to go out to the beach, and I thought to myself, gosh, it's going to be great. I'm going to rest. It's going to be quiet. No. But it was so fun. But actually, there were some times out there that I got away for a little bit and just walked on the beach or had some quiet time. And we need to take that quiet time, not just in the summer, not just when we're getting ready to go back to school, but there are times that we need to take that permission and that statement from Jesus and take it to heart and go away and rest for a while, okay? So that's the first aspect of this passage I want to point out to you, is quiet. That's rest. The second part, go down a little bit in the passage there. And he sees the crowd, and what's the emotion that it says Jesus has? He has compassion on this crowd. You see that word? He had compassion on them. Now this word compassion, this Greek word for compassion there, is used in the Gospels 9 different times, and every time a miracle follows, when Jesus has compassion, a miracle follows. Why do I point that out to you? Because as Christian people, we are called upon to have times of quiet, and we are called upon to have times of compassion. There are things that we don't expect that come upon us, maybe not at a convenient time, but that gut-wrench compassion is what we're talking about here. The Greek word here for compassion is the same word as basically your guts. Okay? It is that gut-wrenching compassion. And that's actually where that idea and expression of gut-wrenching comes from, because of this concept that is from deep within. It's the kind of gut-wrenching emotion that Jesus felt at the grave of his friend Lazarus when Jesus wept. Our Lord had compassion on the widow at Nain when her son had died, and he comes upon them going out to the funeral. It's that deep compassion that God calls us to have. So quiet and compassion. And then the third movement of this Gospel passage that I want to share with you, and that I want you to think about today is another statement that Jesus makes a little further down, because there's not enough to go around. And the disciples, they said, well, let's just send them away. Now, there's no McDonald's out there. But he says, just send them away to the towns. Let them get something to eat. What does Jesus say back to them? You give them something to eat. This third movement I would call cooperation with God. God calls us, and God wants us to cooperate with God to accomplish something that we don't think we can do, that we don't think we can accomplish. And we can't. But as we heard this morning in the reading that Mary did and from the Spark lesson, there was so much left. How many baskets were left over, remember, from your reading? 12. There were 12 baskets left over. You think there's any coincidence with that? How many disciples did we have, apostles? 12. How many tribes of Israel? 12. What's the gospel writer trying to tell you? There's enough for everyone left over. And what does Jesus do with that, with those loaves that are given to him? He takes them, he blesses, breaks, and gives. You think there's any symbolism to that? This is a Eucharistic communal sharing by our Lord in cooperation with the disciples, who give him what they have. It's all they have. And he takes it, and he breaks it, blesses, and gives it. There are times that we can accomplish things we don't think we can do by ourselves. How are we going to possibly give school supplies to all the children in this community and city and meeting? We can't do it by ourselves. But you know what I've seen through this watch group, again, is this effort multiplying. An email this week, Vicki, I don't think you even know about this, from the city, from a woman named Mindy, who got in touch about the city's effort for back to school. Hey, I heard y'all were doing this. Can we use y'all as a drop-off site? It's growing. And there's a blue backpack out there in the middle of the aisle this morning for anything you want to donate to this effort. To help those who don't have enough to eat or to go back to school with anything that you can put in there. We can't do it on our own. Father Joe, this week in the staff, I said, what does this passage mean to y'all in our staff Bible study on Wednesday? He said, you know, there are times that I just don't think I can do it by myself. And that's right, we can't. But when we work with God and when we hear God's call, we can. And God does. And all we give is what we can give. And then God takes it from there. So, three movements, three passages, if you will, in here. And Jesus says, you give them something to eat. And then, the top of page 7. How many loaves do you have? Go and see, Jesus says. God sends us out. God calls us out. God calls us into the quiet sometimes. God calls us out to times of compassion. And God calls us out to cooperate with him and to accomplish something great that we never could do on our own. I want to circle back and close up with reminding you about the memories. This memory of the loaves and the fishes was so strong that the gospel writers, every one of them wrote it down. Every one of them, all four of them, counted it. It was a strong memory. It was a great memory. Like the mud pit, like the beach zoo, like the talent night, like game night. Things that the gospel writers remembered. This is one of them. What do I want you to remember about this gospel account? Remember the quiet, that it's okay to have quiet, and God calls you into it sometimes. Remember God calling you to go and give them something to eat, to have compassion, and to cooperate with God. We all journey and walk with Jesus and make memories doing so. Amen? Amen. Stand with me now, and let's profess our faith together. Page 7, words of Nicene Creed. Page 7. We believe in one God, Father, the Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth.
Let us offer our prayers to God. Lord God, we thank you for the leaders of our church, especially Archbishop Beach, Bishop Lawrence, Bishop Skelton, Father Marshall, Father Donnie, Father Joe, Father David, Deacon Lee, and our staff, and we ask you to bless them. We also pray for St. Andrew's Mission and their vicar, Father Jimmy Gallant. Lord God, we pray for all those who proclaim the gospel at home and abroad, and for all who teach and disciple others, in particular for All Saints Church in Florence, their rector, Father Jason Hamshaw, Chelsea, and their family, for San Jose Church in the Dominican Republic, their rector, Father Sanzino Sanchez, and their bishop, Moises Quezada. And for Father Rob Sturdy, Anglican chaplain at the Citadel. Lord God, we pray for the leaders of our country, especially President Biden, Governor McMaster, Mayor Tecklenburg, and we ask you to bless them. Lord God, we thank you for our blessings, especially for people who love and care for us. Lord God, we ask you to take care of anyone who is sick or sad.
Especially this morning, we pray for the Newman family, Rick and Dawn and Tyler, as they mourn the death of Desi Newman. We also pray for Dawn Quick as she recovers from surgery. For Ron Navinet, Julian Adams, David Peckert, Nancy Lynn, Martha Bell, Bob and Margaret Jones.
Lord God, we know you hear us when we pray, and we ask that you answer our prayers as may be best for us.
I invite you all to join me now as we pray together for the selection of the bishop for our diocese. Praying together, Almighty God, giver of every good gift, look graciously on your church, and so guide the minds of those who praying for your people, equipping us for ministry, and leading us forth in the fulfillment of the Great Commission. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Good morning. Welcome to St. Andrews today. And I want to begin the announcements with a thank you to Brenda for all she did in making Beach Weekend such a great weekend. Still recovering from all that good food out there and a great time. So thanks for all you did. And want to invite at this point Brian to come on out. Brian and I are going to be at the Sonic across from the high school on Wednesday night at 7 for Slushy Wednesday, okay? So come on out and join us. And one of the things I want to talk about Wednesday night, and I want you guys who can come out and y'all get the word around, please, that we're going to have it. We'll get the word out, of course. But I don't know about you, but I miss Brad. We all miss Brad. But be thinking about what does this next youth minister, what qualities, what things, help me fill out the job description. What is this person going to do? What does this person need to be like? We can't have a duplicate of Brad, but we can think about some of the qualities we might like, and that's what I want to talk about Wednesday night with y'all at Celestial Wednesday, okay? So be thinking about that, and I'm going to take some notes and hear your thoughts, okay? So Celestial Wednesday will be Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. I mentioned the blue backpack in the middle of the aisle. Please help fill that up with cash or with checks out to the church. That will all go towards back-to-school supplies. There's a back-to-school table on the patio set up where you can adopt a child and get school supplies for that child or find out a little bit more about this great effort that's going on among us. For those of you visiting today, the welcome table out, the blue welcome table will be on the patio, and a couple of vestry members will be there to tell you a little bit more about our church. And we'll also be having a lemonade stand out there this morning to wish Father Donnie well in his new ministry. Now, he's going to be going off and already has started his training with the Charleston County Sheriff's Office. He's going to need times of quiet and a time of break and a time of pause and a time of refresh occasionally. And I pray that God will call to him and that he will listen to that call when it comes to pause and to refresh. And certainly for compassion as he ministers and serves this county and state in serving the people of this county with compassion. And then walking with God and his continued ministry. So I want to pray for him. I want to ask you all to stand now as we pray for him. Donnie will come out in the middle here. And then join us for the next stand afterwards to be able to talk a little bit more with Father Donnie. The Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
Let's pray. Lord, our Heavenly Father, whose blessed Son came not to serve, to be served, but to serve others, we ask you for your continued blessing upon Father Donnie. Following in Jesus' steps, Lord, as he gives of himself in the service of others, especially with his work in the Sheriff's Office. Endue him, Lord, with continued wisdom, with your patience, with courage and compassion, that he may strengthen the weak and raise up those who fall. And being inspired by your love, may worthily minister to the suffering, friendless, and needy, all for the sake of him who laid down his life for us, your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Walk in love now, as Christ loved us, and gave himself an offering and a sacrifice to God. You may be seated.
Thank you.
It is right, in our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Thank you.
Thanksgiving for what happens to you today, but the word is that.
Lord, we pray Thanksgiving.
Heavenly Father,
we thank you for feeding us spiritual food on the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you.
Yeah.